Okay, so first I want to thank organizers, the moderators of the seminar for the possibility to speak. Thank you very much. So let G be a real algebraic group. Say G is a subgroup of G and C defined by polynomials with real coefficients. We have the group of real points, G of R, the group of complex points, G of C, and an anti-holomorphic involution, sigma, G of C to G of C, G goes to complex conjugate element. And we're still in G of C because our group is defined by equations with real coefficients. Then C is an anti-holomorphic involution, and sigma square is the identity. Is anti-holomorphic, and its sigma square is identity. But say then that sigma is an anti-holomorphic involution. We have also the group G, non-bold. I denote by G non-bold the corresponding real, the corresponding complex algebraic group. Conversely, from a connected reductive complex algebraic group G and an anti-holomorphic involution, sigma S of C to G of C to G of C, by Galois descent, we obtain a real algebraic group G. So instead of working with algebraic group given by real algebraic group given by polynomials with real coefficients, we can work with a complex algebraic group and an anti-holomorphic involution. We call this anti-holomorphic involution the real structure on G. We write G bold is G sigma. Okay. Okay. Now let G bold be G sigma. We define the set of one cocycles, that one of R G, as the set of A such that in our group, such that A times sigma of A equals one. This is the definition of a cocycle. The group G of C acts on cocycles as follows. We choose G in G of C and it sends A to G, G of G times A times sigma of G minus one. One check that interaction, and by definition, the first cohomology set H1 of R G is the set of orbits of this action. It has a neutral element, the class of the cocycle one. So the Galois cohomology answers important questions. It's not necessary to describe in this seminar why Galois cohomology is interesting, but still I will say. If H bold in G bold is an R subgroup, and we consider the homogeneous space G modulo H, it's again a real algebraic variety, then the set of orbits of G of R in Y of R in a canonical bijection with the kernel of the canonical map H1 of H to H1 of RG. Maybe this is the main application of the Galois cohomology, though not the only. Okay. We denote by G of R2 the set of real elements in G of R such that G square is 1. If A in G of R2, then A times sigma of A equals A square, because A is real, equals one. So we see that G of R2 is contained in the set of cocycles. Okay. From now on, our G is a connected semi-simple R group. I describe a simple combinatorial algorithm which permits to compute the Galois multiset H1 over G in terms of the affine Dynkin diagram of G. This algorithm is due to Victor Katz. It appeared first in his one, maybe two notes of the year 68 for adjoint groups. There were no proofs, but you can find proofs in the book of Helgason. Katz described his proofs to Helgason, and Helgason published them in his book. The idea in this simply connected case is due to Winberg, who explained it to me in an email message of 2008. I asked him whether this could be done without the word cohomology, but I explained what I need, and he said, yes, it's possible, and wrote, and I did not understand. And later I asked Dmitry Timashev, whether he understands what he Winberg wrote, and he said, yes, I understand. And this is how this work started. Mm-hmm. Okay, I explained the algorithm. Okay, I will explain the algorithm in the example E7. I start from the adjoint case. Due to Victor Katz. So we have a group G of type I7, an adjoint group, T maximal torus, B aberrative group, R of G, T general system, and S of G, TB, the system of simple roots. So we have a system of simple roots. There are seven, alpha one, alpha two, alpha seven. And this is the Dynkin diagram, but this is not what we need. We need a fine Dynkin diagram. And at the end of the talk, I will explain why we indeed need the affine Dynkin diagram. So we need the affine or extended Dynkin diagram. This is a diagram. You see here additional root alpha naught. Now we have eight roots in a seven dimensional space, namely alpha naught is the lowest root. Maybe I put it the lowest root. Alpha naught is minus alpha h is the highest root in R with respect to the system of simple roots S. Okay, we have eight roots in seven dimensional space, and so there is a linear relation. This is a linear relation. Normalize says that M naught equal one. And one can see that here M1, M2, M7 are positive integer, because look, the highest root alpha h is a linear combination of simple roots with integer positive coefficients. And this mi are known, and you can take here they are, and you can find them in the book of Bourbaki or in the books or in one in any of two books of Anishchik and by Anishchik and Winberg. This is the coefficients. So this is here one, two. Some of them are red and some of them are gray. I put in gray those who are greater than two. For my problem, they are not important, because the Galois group of C over R is about two. Two is a very important number for us, the cardinality of the Galois group. So we have the coefficients, and now the fundamental definition. Okay. CATS labeling of the extended Dimkin diagram B theta is a family QI of numerical labels which are non-negative integers, Q0, Q1, Q and so on, Q7, such that sum of MI QI equals 2. Again, 2 is the cardinality of the Galois group. Now it's clear that QI are less or equal to 2 than 2, because if we put here 2, then 3, we certainly get the sum greater than 2. Moreover, Q3, Q4, and Q5 are 0. Or again, if we put here 1, if we put here 1, then we get 3, and we're permitted to have only 2. Okay, if somebody has any question, it's completely okay to interrupt me in the middle. I would be happy if you interrupt me. Okay. Now let's see what are the CATS labeling in our problem. So I put it like this. So you see the coefficients. So we can put here 2, and we have 2 times 1, all the other zeros. Here we put 2, and we get linear combination 2. Look here. So we get this. Or we can put 2 here, and we get this. Or we can put here, or we can put here 1, and here 1, and we get this. Or we can put here 1, we get this. Or we can put here 1, and we get this. Or at least we can put here 1, and we get this. So we have exactly 6 CATS labelings. 6 CATS labelings. We denote the set of all CATS labelings by K of D tilde. D tilde is the extended Dimkin diagram. So K is not the K group, K is CATS here. Okay. Now we consider the adjoint group. I remind that we consider the adjoint group. And it's known that its fundamental group is of order 2. It's the cardinality of the center of simply connected group. So we denote it F, fundamental. It has 2 elements, 1 row. Row is a non-trivial element. And it acts on the extended Dimkin diagram by the only non-trivial automorphism. You see, the Dimkin diagram has no non-trivial automorphism, but the extended Dimkin diagram has more automorphisms than the usual Dimkin diagram. Here, this is the automorphism. So our group, fundamental group F, acts on the affine Dimkin diagram and on the set of CATS labeling. And we denote by K of DT by modular F the set of orbits. So let's compute the orbits. So first theorem, CATS 69, consider the adjoint group, the adjoint sigma C. C means compact. So we consider the compact group, compact adjoint group of type E7. Then its Galois cohomology is in canonical bijection with the set of orbits of F, the fundamental group of order 2, in the set of CATS labelings. Okay, what are the orbits? We have 6 CATS labeling, and the group acts. The group acts by reflection with respect to the vertical symmetry axis. So maybe I put it. So maybe here, just one moment. So this is our symmetry axis. Okay. So we see that there are four orbits. So the galactic cosmology is of cardinality four. The galactic cosmology of the adjoint group of type E7 is of cardinality four. Okay, so we know the cardinality, but it's not all. We want to see cycles, how it corresponds to cocycles, explicit cocycles. So let's do it. Here I should use roots and weights and so on, because it's the only way how we can work with E7. It's an exceptional group. Okay. So let T be any C torus. We consider the character group of T, homomorphism from T to C star, and we consider the co-character group, the homomorphism from C star to T. And these two groups are in duality. We define a pairing characters times co-characters to Z as follows. We take a character chi, we take a co-character nu, and we consider the composition, the composite map, C star, nu to T, C star, nu to T, and chi to C star. And so this is an endomorphism of C star, and given by Z goes to Zn for some natural number, for some integer n. And so we put the pairing of chi and nu is this n. So we get, and it's well known that this is a perfect pairing, defined duality. Good. Okay. Now our group, we return to our group, adjoint group, compact, sigma C, here C means that it corresponds, this involution corresponds to the compact real form. The adjoint the maximal torus. I have to introduce some lattices which have their own names. So Q is the characters of the adjoint, and PV is co-characters of the adjoint. And they are dual. The notation is not so nice, but it's standard. Q is dual to PV because it's characters and co-characters of the same torus. So we have a pairing in the set. Now we take some cuts labeling Q, Q0, Q1, Q2, Q7, and we define a co-character Q hat in PV by the pairing of root alpha I and Q hat is QI. For all simple roots alpha I, I1 to 7, and we do not use alpha naught. So we, in this way, we get a co-character Q hat from C star to T adjoint. Now we consider the element AQ, Q hat of -1, living in T adjoint. So we take homomorphism from C star to T adjoint, we apply it to -1, and it goes to some element AQ, which we denote by Q hat of -1, and it's of order 2, of order dividing 2, and our torus is real. So every element of order dividing 2 is real. Our torus is compact, I forgot, our torus is compact, and therefore it's real. So it's real element of order dividing 2, so it is a cocycle. In this way, we get a cocycle. Again, we start from Q, a cuts labeling, we construct a co-character Q hat, we apply it to -1, we obtain a complex element of order dividing 2, it is real, so it's a real element of order dividing 2, so it's cocycle. And we take its cohomology class, and this is the map. So we start from a cuts labeling up to automorphism of the extended diagram, and we get a cohomology class. From Q, we get this AQ equals Q hat of -1, and we take its cohomology class. so. Mm-hmm. Now we can consider twisting. So to Q in K of T, we associate a twisted group. We get other real form of our group, not necessarily compact, non-compact forms. We take the same group, G adjoint, but with new real structure, sigma Q, AQ composition sigma C. What does it mean? Our AQ lives in adjoint torus. So it lives in the adjoint group. But the adjoint group is a group of inner automorphism. So we can consider this AQ as an automorphism, holomorphic automorphism, involution, holomorphic involution of our group. Now we take the composition, sigma C is anti-holomorphic, AQ is holomorphic, we get sigma Q anti-holomorphic. And since AQ is a cocycle, we get an involution. Sigma Q squared, maybe I write it, sigma Q squared equals identity, because AQ is a cocycle. It's more or less the same as the definition of a cycle. So we get a new holomorphic, anti-holomorphic involution, a new real form. Okay, and in this way, we get four groups. Four real groups. So, okay, maybe I have to write. Here I write maximal compact subgroup. Maximal compact. We have how to recognize our group. We recognize them by maximal compact subgroups. How we get a maximal compact subgroup? By the method of cuts as follows. We throw away the non-zero element. We throw it away, we get E7. We throw away here all vertices with non-zero labels. We get E6. I hope it's clear. We throw away this, we get E6. But okay, it's also we must get a group of rank 7. So we add a one-dimensional torus, we get a maximal compact subgroup of rank 7. Okay, it's a Hermitian form. Look, it has a non-reductive maximal compact, a non-semi-simple maximal compact subgroup. It has one-dimensional circle, which defines the complex structure on the symmetric space. So we get this group. Or we throw away this one and we get non-connected Dynkin diagram, A1 times D6. Or we throw away this one and clearly we get A7. So we get four all real forms of our group 7. So we know now we get classification of real forms of group E7. In his paper of 1914, for Cartan, it took 15 pages of calculations to classify real forms of group E7. Now you see by method of cuts, we classify them very quickly. Okay. Now I want to compute color cohomology of each of those groups. We have here four groups. For compact, we all have already computed. Now we have three others. How to compute the Galois cohomology? The formula is as follows. We start from a Katz labeling. We take here an element.
Misha, what are the negative numbers on the right in parentheses?
It's some kind of characteristic which is introduced, Cartan. Maybe I think it's some kind of, I forgot the word. It depends on signature of the quadratic form. Skip Garibaldi told me that I should use this notation. And this is standard. I think it's related to the signature of the corresponding quadratic form.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now I want to compute the homology of each of the groups. And the Galois homology is the same set because it's in a twisting, so it's the same set but with different cocycles. And that I explain how we get it. We take here some element P, some Katz labeling P here, and from element P we compute a cocycle. We take P hat minus Q hat. It's some homomorphism from C star to T adjoint. We take the image of minus one. We take P hat minus Q hat of minus one. This is not product. This is the, we apply a homomorphism to minus one. And of course, this P hat minus Q hat, of course you understand that I mean P hat divided by Q hat. It's just the standard additive notation. Actually, we divide the value of first homomorphism to the value of second homomorphism. Now, and we take its value and we get element of order two, and it's real because element of order two is always real in a compact torus. And this is our cocycle. And so this is our cocycle, and this is the vector. And for example, if we take P equal Q, we get here zero. So P hat divided by Q hat is one. So we get the value is one. So with this map, P equals the neutral element, the neutral element correspond to P equal Q. Okay, so this is up to now, it was the work of Katz. He did not use the word homology. Actually, what he did was computation of some other group, homology group, equivalent to computation of homology of some other group, automorphism group. But in our case, the automorphism group is the same as in automorphism group, which is the same as the adjoint group. So this is exactly what Katz computed, but he didn't say the word homology. But this is exactly what he computed. Okay, now let's go to something new. And this is simply connecting group. So simply connected is seven. And so we have four groups. We write G simply connected Q for the group G simply connected and sigma Q, where sigma Q was defined above. And this is the universal cover of G adjoint Q. Mm-hmm. And we take T simply connected, the corresponding maximal torus. And we consider certain lattices, which again have their own names, P characters of T simply connected. Then P is a greater lattice, is a larger lattice. Q is a sublattice of index two in P. So P is generated by Q and some character gamma. And we can find this gamma from any table, from tables in the book of Anishtik and Winberg, or in the book by Bourbaki. I mean Bourbaki, Lie groups and Lie algebras, chapter 4, 5, 6, the best book of Bourbaki. And we take this element, this lambda, and we can take, for example, half alpha 2 plus alpha 5 plus alpha 7. And I write it as lambda equals some C alpha, where C alpha are coefficients. So coefficients are either zero or half. So alpha in C. And now we define this is new. We define the set K of D tilde Q for given Q is the same of P Katz labeling, such the sum of C alpha P alpha is congruent to sum on C alpha Q alpha modulus L. The sum is over simple root, so there's 7 elements. But actually, of course, it's 3, you see. You see alpha non-zero only for 3. Okay, so this is, as I will explain later, the Galois in canonical projection is Galois homology of the simply connected group. Of this simply connected group. Okay. All right. QV, the co-character group of T simply connected, homomorphic from C status T simply connected. QV is small, is a sublattice in PV of index 2. For any P in K of D tilde, the condition that P in K of D tilde Q means exactly as P hat minus Q hat is contained in QV, not just in PV, but in QV. Okay, this is just calculation. So we get P hat minus Q hat, a homomorphism from C star to T simply connected. So it's a homomorphism to T adjoint, but I can also regard it as a homomorphism to T simply connected. And we take P hat minus Q hat, apply it to minus one, we get an element of T simply connected. And it is of order 2 because minus 1 square is 1. And so we get a real element because our torus is compact. And so we get a cycle. And now a theorem of Weinberg, who wrote it in a message to me in 2008, myself and Dmitry Timashev, that this map, that the map from K of D to the Q to Galois homology, which takes P, Katz labeling P to the cohomology class of element of the cocycle P hat minus Q hat of minus one, to H1 to the cohomology is a big junction. So now we have computed, thanks to Weinberg, the Galois homology of H1 of K of G simply connected Q for any Q. And this, and we already also wrote explicit cocycles. Explicit cocycles are this for any P, we get this explicit cocycle. Questions? Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's compute what are these set K of D tilde Q. This is our extended Dynkin diagram. Remember that we get some C alpha Q alpha half Q2 plus Q5 plus Q7 because all the other coefficients are zero. And these coefficients alpha are 1/2. Now Q5 is zero because here we have coefficient 3. So we get half Q2 plus Q7. So we want to consider this sum modulus Z. Let us multiply by 2 and define S of Q equals Q2 plus Q7. The sum is taken over the blue vertices. This vertex is not important because here the coefficient is great, 3. Then P is K of D tilde Q if and only if S of P is congruent S of Q modulo 2. Okay, so let us compute what all this means. We say that a Katz labeling Q is even maybe I wrote it, is even if SFQ is even. So these are the even and odd cuts labelings. Here, this labeling is even, 0 plus 0. This is even, 2 plus 0 is 2, it's even. This is even, 0 plus 0 is even. And this is, and this is even. And this is odd, 1 plus 0 is odd, and this is odd. We have 4 even labelings and 2 odd labelings. Now, if Q is even, then the Galois cohomology set is in a canonical bijection with K even, the set of even labeling, and hence H1 of R, G simply connected, of simply connected group is of cardinality 4. And if Q is odd, then it is in the canonical bijection with K odd, and hence the cardinality is 2. Okay. Skip Peribaldi and Nikita Semenov in 2010 computed H1 of this group, and they got 4. And Brian Conrad in 2016 computed the Galois cohomology of this split group. And the cardinality was 2. And Adams and Taibbi in 2018, and also I and my student Evan Noor in 2016 computed in all 4 cases. But here we have explicit cocycles. This calculation is better because we get explicit cocycles, and also we have a map. Maybe write it here. Maybe write it here. We have a homomorphism, for example, G simply connected. Simply connected. Q to G adjoined Q. We have a map. Here we have a cocycle cohomology class corresponding to some cocycle, say P. Then here we have the cohomology class corresponding to the same labeling P. It's a very nice description. It permits, I will say it later, it permits to compute certain homomorphisms, map of Galois homology corresponding to certain nice homomorphisms. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now let's consider the half spin group. And so maybe I see it, half spin group. It's a compact group, or I can see the compact group of type DL1 with even L greater or equal to 4, which is neither simply connected nor adjoint, and not isomorphic to SO2L.
Misha, I noticed that the odd classes are invariant under the Galois group, but the even ones are not. Is that a coincidence?
Okay. This is not, it's important in certain calculations, but now it's not class. These are representative of orbits. So here we consider the orbit. Maybe I go back. So. They correspond to orbits. Here you see the orbit, it's 2 elements. This is not invariant, so we take orbit of 2 elements, and here orbit of 1 element, and here orbit of 2 elements, of 2 labels is orbit of 1 element. but for certain calculation, for Galois homology of reductive groups, for certain exact sequences, we do, it is important that some of them invariant fixed under the automorphism group and some are not. More questions?
I was talking about the simply connected case, not the adjoint case.
But in simply connected cases, we considered the or, okay, you're right. Okay, you're right. So let's see. Let's see what. Okay.
Yeah, right here.
Yes. Okay. Okay, so it's also related to something. We compute. So we consider. Okay, Z to G simply connected to G adjoint, and we have H1 of Z, and it gets to H1 of G simply connected, and it acts, actually this abelian group acts on this, and what you noticed related to this action. I cannot think in real time where I stay at the blackboard or when I sit at the computer, but this is important, but not for this problem. It is important and it is used it is used in calculations. And because of this, some answers are different.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now we consider half-spin group. And this group is neither simply connected nor adjoint, and it is not isomorphic to SO, so the orthogonal group, a special orthogonal group. It is the quotient of the spinner group by some skew subgroup of order two. There are two such skew subgroups. Okay, I think I will skip this, but it is in my notes, and my notes are on my my note, maybe I can send a message. Okay, these notes are on my webpage and I will send a link at the end of the talk of it if I do not forget. So you can read it if you like, this example in my notes. And I will skip it now and continue. Maybe I just show some pictures in the middle. So it's again some combinatorics like this, but I will skip it. Again, combinatorics. And again, we get cardinalities. Here it is. Three or five, and explicit for cycles. Half-spin group is neither simply connected nor adjoint, so we get both action of the fundamental group and congruences. Congruences because it is not adjoint, and action of the fundamental group because the fundamental group is non-trivial and our group is not simply connected. Okay. In the case when our group is an outer form of the compact group, we should consider twisted affine linking diagrams. As in the note of Katz in the books by Anishchik and Winter. For example, this is the linking diagram of the group A to K minus one twisted two. Two is the image of the Galois group in the automorphic group of the Dynkin diagram. But it is outer form of a compact group, not outer form of a split group. This group can be SL to KR S N K H H are quaternions. So the, here in the Galois cohomology of real Galois cohomology, the best group is compact group. And the group which is not compact, which is out of form of compact group, they are difficult. When you work over arbitrary field, the best group is split group. And for real over R, the best group is compact group. So this group is out of form of a compact group. Now here G is, if the group G is adjoint, the fundamental group acts on D tilde by the reflection with respect to the horizontal symmetry axis. And so this is the symmetry axis. And this is the only non-trivial automorphism of the affine Dedekind diagram. When G is simply connected, we take an element labeling P lives in K of D tilde Q if and only if PK equals QK. PK equals QK, where K is this blue vertical. We can take non-zero elements, or here one, or here one, or here one. We don't have many possibilities because the coefficients are two, and we must get some two. So we can put here one, or here one, here one. Okay, in this way, we can also consider semi-simple groups, not only reductive. We can consider not only simple groups. So we can consider a semi-simple group. Here my simple group, and it's absolutely similar. Okay. Questions? Now I answer the question which you don't ask. The question is as follows: why are these extended affine Dedekind diagrams? Why they are important? How do they come from? And now I will explain. I will say idea of proof. And this is not the proof of Katz, who considered automorphism of Lie algebras. And this automorphism always adjoint. And another construction is in the books of Onishchik and Weinberg, two books, algebraic groups and Lie groups, year 90, both exist in English. And the other book is volume 41, of Encyclopedia of Mathematical Sciences. So the idea is as follows. First, assume for simplicity that G is a compact connected group, and let T be a maximal torus. And then there is a theorem of Borel and Serre of the year 64, from the famous paper, Theorem Definitude, from which non-abelian Galois cohomology started, and which also this result was repeated in Serre's book of the year 65, the following. Consider the maximal torus T. Our group is compact. We consider a maximal torus T. Take elements of order two. They are all cocycles. We have an embedding inclusion on cocycles. And this embedding induces a bijection. T of R, two elements of order two, modulo the Weyl group in H1 of R. So we get an answer. Galois cohomology is T of R, two modulo W. This answer is not that good. This set is very big. It's of order two to rank group. And this group is also very big, very large, not big, very large. So the idea is how to find a smaller set here and a smaller group. Okay, I explained the idea. Let T be a compact R torus. the co-character group X sub star naturally be embedded in the Lie algebra. We have this T is complex Lie algebra, this TR is real Lie algebra. We consider the surjective homomorphism E from T of R from real Lie algebra to the torus. X goes to exponent 2PIX. This kernel I X star. And we may identify our real points of torus by the Lie algebra model of this lattice. This is the idea. Okay. Now let us assume that our group G is simple and adjoint. Instead of computing elements T of adjoint of R elements of order 2 of modulo double, we compute all elements of our torus modulo double. We take elements of all elements, real elements of our torus modulo double. We want to compute the quotient. So this is algebra, Lie algebra, modular lattice, modular W. We get some easy transformations, and we get algebra, Lie algebra, modular W tilde, and then modular the fundamental group, where W tilde is W times semi-direct product IQ. This W tilde is called the affine Weyl group. So the answer is as follows. In order to compute the quotient of our torus modular W, we should take it modular W tilde and then modular the fundamental group or general. Now this affine Weyl group W is a reflection group acting on TR, and it has a fundamental domain delta described in Bourbaki's book, Lie groups and Lie algebras 4, 5, 6. I mean, of course, chapters 4, 5, 6. This is a beautiful book. Excellent book. And this quotient is a simplex, which in suitable coordinates is given by one equation and some inequality, and this is the equation. M naught Q naught plus M1 Q1 and so on plus ML QL equals 2, and QI in R and QI are greater than equal 0, and M naught are our M naught we saw before. So, our Dynkin affine Dynkin diagram is the Dynkin diagram of the affine Weyl group, and this affine Weyl group appears here. It appears here. Now we obtain, so this is delta, and we obtain that. Our quotient is in canonical vector. This quotient is delta, and this quotient is delta modulo F, where F is the fundamental group. Where the fundamental group F acts on delta by the automorphism of the affine Dynkin diagram. The automorphism we have already seen. So we got real points of torus. Now we want integer points of order 2. Then we should take integer values of QI and that is we get that Q is a Katz labeling. So we obtain that our Galois homology is the shape of Katz labeling modulo F for adjoint group, compact adjoint group. if we take a simply connected group instead of adjoint group, then we get T simply connected of R modulo W, and this will be delta, just delta. We don't have to take quotient by the fundamental group because the fundamental group is trivial. Our group is simply connected. But to guarantee that our point comes from correspond to element of order two in T simply connected, we should add congruences. Congruences. And so that's what we get. We get that H1 of G simply connected is K of D tilde Q. So we take K of D tilde and add congruences. And add congruences. I have 2 minutes. Good. Now I want to say what we can do with all this. What we can do with all this. First, for a connected semi-simple R group G, we give H1 of R G nice combinatorial pictures with explicit cocycles. Now, for a normal homomorphism of semi-simple R groups, G to G prime, we can compute the map on Glock homology in terms of Katz labeling. A homomorphism is called normal if its image is normal. For example, any subjective homomorphism is normal. So for a normal homomorphism, you write the first formula that comes to mind, and it turns out to be true, correct. Very nice. Okay, what else? For a short exact sequence, 1 to A, G, G prime, for isogeny, where A is a semi-simple R group G, we can compute a 7-term exact sequence, A of R, P naught G of R, P naught G prime of R, and so on, and then the homology. We can compute first these groups. These are abelian groups in terms of Katz labeling and these cohomology sets and all maps in terms of Glock homology. Okay, what else? For if A is ecocycle, we can compute the twisting projection. We consider the twisted group AG and we have a canonical map bijection tau alpha from Serre's book from H1 of RG to H1 of RAG to H1 of RG, sending one here to A here, and we compute this map. So we compute almost everything which we would like, but not all, not all. What we do not compute, if you remember, we considered some group H in G subgroup, and we wanted to compute, we had to compute the kernel H1 of R H to H1 of R G. In this method, we cannot compute it, and I think it's impossible to compute it in a nice way without computing. I'm planning to participate in writing a computer program which will compute this map. And I have hope and I have in mind a certain somebody who can write such a program. Thank you. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much, Misha. Are there any questions?
So just to say, the slides will appear on my webpage 5 minutes after the talk finishes. It's already there, but I just have to put the link. So the slides will be accessible on my webpage.
Perhaps you can put the link into the chat.
I must, how I can do it. Let's, maybe I can do it now. Just one moment. There is chat. I don't see chat.
Can you do it for other types? You had an example with a half spin.
Okay, every group, we cannot hope to do for any group because then we should have to do it for simple, for finite simple groups. So let's consider a connected group. Graph homology of a connected group, from a connect, in a connected group, we take, in a connected group, we take unipotent radical, and then the quotient doesn't change cohomology. It's a lemma of Sansuk. So it reduces to the case of a reductive group. Yes, we're finishing a preprint where with a calculation of Galois homology for a reductive, for a real reductive group. It's not that nice because it uses Delissage. But using our result for semi-simple group, we get a good, sufficiently nice combinatorial algorithm to compute the Galois homology for connected reductive groups in terms of some combinatorics, in terms of Katz labelings. But it's not that nice. It's not, it's the visage. No, I could write it, but I have already stopped sharing, so I don't write it. Yes, it can be done, and I hope that in a month, a preprint will appear in our archive. We could not put it in our first preprint just because we had a restriction on volume in the collection where it is to be published, if it is accepted, of course.
Thank you. Okay, so let me ask for questions one more time. If there are no questions, let's thank the speaker again.